Welcome to the Great American Collectibles Show, heard Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m. Eastern on PSA.com and the PSA Facebook page. The Great American Collectibles Show is brought to you by PSA and the National Sports Collectors Convention. Tonight's headlines are brought to you by Sports Collectors Daily. For all of your hobby news, features, and more, visit sportscollectorsdaily.com. And now, your hosts, Tom Zappala and Rico Petrocelli.
Rico, how are you, my pen?
All right, good boy.
How's your back?
I'm having trouble with my lower back, my upper back. I had trouble with my upper back, so I went to physical therapy after going to the doctor. So they were rubbing it and all that good. And the next time I went, it went down to my lower back.
Well, maybe you're swinging the golf club incorrectly.
Well, that's no doubt about that. But no, I've had back problems since I was 23 years old in Cleveland. I went down in batting practice.
And that was the end of that.
That was that.
All right, listen, we're going to bring in our guest right now, Calvin Arnold from REA Auctions. Calvin, how are you, buddy?
Doing great, guys. How are you? Thanks for having me.
Listen, our headlines today, and remember, today is Friday. I know you're watching the show 4 or 5 days later, so I know the word is already out and everybody knows. But, you know, this is kind of bittersweet for Rico and I and Ellen. You know, Joe Orlando sent a letter out. I'm going to just read the first and last paragraph. I know by now most of you know. But I just wanted to read this. Without a doubt, this message was the most difficult to write in my nearly 22 years at the company. The title, thank you, is about as vague as a title can get. But I want to keep it simple for those who chose to read it. After more than two decades at Collector's Universe, with most of that time dedicated to PSA in one form or another, I've decided to move on from something that has become such a huge part of my life. It was time for a change. In addition to spending more time with my family, I'm looking forward to staying active in the hobby personally. Now, I'm not going to read the whole letter, but I'm going to go down to the last paragraph. And I know that, again, most of you have probably already read this. His last paragraph says, I'm a collector through and through. It's how I'm wired, and that's not going to change. I can't wait to see what the next two or three decades has in store for all of us. The hobby is continually expanding, maturing, and improving. It's a great time to be a collector, and more people that share our gene are being introduced to our way of life each day. No matter what I decide to do from this point forward with my work life, I will be a collector for life, forever grateful. Joe Orlando, President and CEO of Collectors Universe. So Joe has decided to step down, and Nat Turner is immediately taking over as the CEO of Collectors Universe. From a personal standpoint,
I know you're very close. We've been very close with Joe. Tom, and it's really sad. We're going to miss him because he's done such a great job. He's been a good friend of ours, and the times we had at the National, spent some time with him, and that had lots of fun. And he's done a lot for the industry.
Actually, I don't need it. No, he has, Reek. And the thing though that you know, we've spoken several times this week. And one thing he promised me, and he also promised Nat, which Ellen and I were really taken aback. As many of you know, we announced last week that we were just commissioned, Ellen and I, to do probably our last book. And we're real excited about the book. The book is going to be called The Diamondbacks Collection. 50 of the greatest cards in sports collecting history. You know, it's going to be on the collection owned by Arizona Diamondbacks owner and general managing partner Kenny Kendrick. And Joe had signed on to do the book with Ellen and I, and Joe has promised us that he will do the book with us. So really pleased that Joe has decided to finish off the book with us, because you know we're going to be working together for probably the better part of a year, because the book will be launched next year at the 2022 National. But In any event, thank you, Joe. Joe Orlando. And Calvin, you can jump in because you've been in this business a long time, too. Joe really, I look at Joe Orlando. I want to put him in the same category as the first induction class at the Baseball Hall of Fame. You know, the Cobbs, the Garrick, I mean, the Cobbs, the Roots, all of those guys, the Walter Johnson. Joe Orlando really took this hobby slash industry to a new level over the last 22 years. Calvin, would you agree with that?
Yeah, I echo your guys' sentiment. I mean, I think the hobby at large owes Joe a great debt of gratitude. I mean, I think that he's meant a lot to the hobby. He's really revolutionized a lot of things. And over his 20 plus years at PSA, you know, I honestly don't think that the hobby would be where it is currently without the, you know, contributions that Joe made.
Rico, you know what Joe thought of you. Joe thinks the world of you and still does, although I can't imagine why. But he does think the world of you. So, again, I don't know where he's going to land. Best to Joe and his beautiful wife, Kristen, and the two boys. So see what happens.
Yeah. Like he said, he's staying in the business. He's going to come up somewhere. Not sure where either, but and he loves collecting, and so you know that'll be great.
He'll land on his feet. I think this is going to be a very,
he will.
This is going to be a very positive thing for Joe, and you know, obviously, we wish him all the best here at REA. Yeah.
Well, you know, I agree. I think he is going to wind up on his seat. And by the way, over the next week or two, Joe will be joining us on this video podcast and on the radio with Rico and I and JM. He wants to talk to the collectors across the country. All right, we've got a good show. We've got Calvin from REA Auctions. Hey, by the way, David, you can hear me, correct?
I can.
I just got a little text from Al. Crisafulli is going to be joining us later on, and he wants to know if you can send him the link. I don't know if you did, but he asked for it. So
I will do that.
All right. We've got a nice show today. Our giveaway. We are giving away. And Joe, Rico, you haven't seen this.
Oh, your beautiful giveaways?
Well, no, it's not the giveaway. I'm talking about the container. You remember the gray plastic container that I've been using?
Yeah.
It melted.
By itself? Would you put it outside?
It was next to the radiator. And
thank God. Hey, get something with class.
So wait a second. So our good friend, Staten Island Joe Marino, sent us this beautiful bag from the Baseball Hall of Fame Museum shop, and we're going to use this, and I guarantee you, and I said this last week, I guarantee you Marino knuckled this. There's no way he paid for this. He knuckled this, I guarantee you.
Well, it's nice. It's nice. Right?
And then we also have one other. This is our On Deck with Rico day, and we're going to do the On Deck with Rico segment, brought to you, by the way, by REA and Brian. And this week's the giveaway, by the way, the giveaway for the regular giveaway is another 20 crappy cards. 20 crappy cards. That's what I call them. Right?
Well, I understand, but they're really not crappy.
These are pretty crappy. They were crappy. So let me ask you a question. What did you think about Bob Scanlon, Rico, as a pitcher for the Cubs?
Bob was who the heck? Who's Bob? I don't remember him.
I was going to wait for that. I mean, Rico was going to have some insight that none of us had on Bob Scanlon.
Yeah, and Rico, what about what was your opinion of Doug Piatt of the Expos? What kind of a pitcher was Doug?
Doug was not a pitcher. He was a groundskeeper.
Montreal.
That's right. And then giveaway for the REA segment with On Deck with Rico. This is kind of cool. We've been talking about our good friend, Rico and I's good friend, and our good friend, former welterweight, undisputed welterweight champ of the world, Tony DeMarco. Tony's really up there now at 90 years young. Tony was over the house a couple of weeks ago. This is a really cool signed little photo. It says, good luck, Tony DeMarco. So that'll be our giveaway later on. But let's get to Calvin. Calvin, we've got a lot to talk about. First of all, were you guys happy with the results of your June auction?
Yeah, I mean, it was more than we expected. I think one of the things, the overall theme with these new Encore auctions is that it adds flexibility for our consigners and our bidders. I mean, we run three major auctions a year, spring, summer, and fall, which are great, the catalog auctions. But this just adds a little bit more depth to what we're able to offer for our clients, and it gives consigners the ability to turn their cards into cash a lot quicker. So it's been a great thing. We started this with the idea that it would be, you know, a nice addition, and it's turned into a lot more than that. So yeah, it was remarkable.
Rick, what are you laughing at?
No, is the vintage market still going strong? No,
Yeah, I mean, the vintage market, I think, is always going to be strong. I think we're going to have peaks and valleys within the markets, just like any other normal market. But, you know, if you have low pop, high grade, rookie cards, anything that's, you know, within the first few years of that player, that major Hall of Famer, I mean, the market is incredibly strong. And what I like to point out, too, is sometimes people take a too short of a view when they're looking at a market. You know, yeah, in the last 3 months, we've had some turbulence, right? I mean, this thing peaked out maybe late February. But if you look at the numbers compared to pre-pandemic, we're still 3, 5, 10, sometimes 20x what we were. So if you're looking at any investment market or, you know, collectible market like this, whether you invest in it or whether you collect, sometimes you have to take the longer view.
Calvin, I want to play the devil's advocate, if I may, for a minute, because I mean, you have your finger on the pulse as a modern market goes. I'm a vintage guy. Everybody knows I'm a vintage guy, and I've always my mantra has always been slow and steady. I've had success over the last 30 years with the appreciation of my vintage collection. It's never gone backwards, to be honest with you, especially my T206 guys. But some of my other vintage stuff, it's not going to explode, but it's slow and steady growth. Yep. My question to you is, if you take the special print Paninis, tops, 1 of 10, you know, all of that stuff, the special issues, put those aside. How can some of these modern cards be worth as much as they are, despite the fact there may be 40, 50,000 of them out there? How does that work?
Yeah, it's a great question. You know, sometimes it can be mind-boggling a lot of people try to compare modern to vintage. And as vintage collectors, I'm more of a vintage collector as well, Tom, but as a vintage collector, like, you know, that's just an unfair comparison. I think what we have to look at is the dynamics between the two different aspects of modern and vintage. Vintage has a subset of people that have been around the hobby a long time, and generally speaking, they've collected as kids. They grew up in, you know, the 60s and 70s, you know, and so they were much closer to those players of that era. I think what the modern's done, it's brought in a whole new class of collectors. I think you're seeing these kids get excited about, you know, the players that they can actually go to the TV screen, watch them play. You know, Devin Booker goes off for 41 points, you know, the other night. And, you know, the cards take an immediate rise because you get this excitement, this, you know, this enjoyment out of being able to connect the card to the player visually. I think a lot of times what happens is that they just can't do that with vintage because those players are, you know, in most
they're
cases,
dead. They're locked dead. On.
Yeah, absolutely, 100%. But I'm going to make a quick distinction here. I think the modern market has actually helped the vintage market, and I'll tell you why. I think the modern market brings the new class of collectors in. I think they collect who they enjoy watching, who they like, their favorite teams, favorite players. But then I think it transcends into them and researching and exploring the hobby as a whole. So they start to look at, like, let's, for example, Shohei Ohtani, right? He pitches and he hits. Who's the last great player that did that?
Babe Ruth.
So they look at Ohtani. You hear all these comparisons through the media. And what do these guys do? They go back and they compare those two, and they start to realize, what Ruth meant to the game. And then they start going from Ruth to the next player to the next player. So I think they're intertwined.
Rico, what do you think? I mean, what do you think about this modern influx of investors, cards? I mean, it has exploded. Last week, Rico, we were talking with JM. We were talking to John Brogy. And John Brogy made a really interesting comment that this year at the National, 46% of the tickets that were sold are first-time attendees.
That's fabulous.
A good sign. That's a good sign. Really, and you've been preaching that. You've been preaching that now, Rico, for 2 years.
Since we've been together.
Drawing these young kids in, and it's starting to work.
It's really important. And guys like Ohtani and Trout and these the great players, and Ohtani is unique. I mean, let's face it.
He's a freak.
But if I'm collecting, I'm interested in the newer cards, you know, the present day player, I'd be buying both. If I could, you know, if I was not a vintage buyer, okay, I'm buying more modern because I'm young. I would absolutely go after those cards now, right now, because Ohtani, as you mentioned, Calvin, you know, even if he, well, if he has a pretty decent career, it's going to, that card's going to be worth a ton of money, let's face it, down the line. And Trout's the same way, and some others as well. So I like that. I like the speculation. I would be looking at the young kids.
It makes me feel good. Yeah. It's good that you're saying it. Coming from you, that carries a lot of weight. You know?
And I agree that, you know, the Ruths and the Cobbs and all these guys that were, you know, that were the beginning of really the age of baseball. And, of course, what Ruth did, you know, he brought the game back after the 1919 scandal and all that. And his card's incredible.
Well, you know what? I was actually happy to see. And I was kind of a critic of it years ago. But I don't know if you guys watched the home run hitting derby at all. Did you watch any of that, Rick?
A little bit, yeah, a little bit.
I'll tell you the thing that really impressed me was I said to Ellen, this is like watching the WWE. You know what I'm saying? And I'll tell you why.
No.
Obviously, the balls were juiced beyond juicing, which is fine, because the whole purpose of the home run hitting contest is entertainment. Notice when they introduce the batters, they go up in that stage and they're holding their bats like this and they're playing rock and roll music, and then I mean, you know, they're jacking bombs outside of the park like 15 in a row, 18 in a row. That was built all around the entertainment to entertain the kids, I think. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I agree. I think entertainment is the order of the day. I mean, I think that's why a lot of these young kids are involved. I think the attention span needs to be captured immediately and often. And I think that's what they've done. And the fact that they can connect these, like I said, connecting these players to the physical card through technology and through entertainment has been huge.
I couldn't agree with you more. Yeah. Rico, one question. And by the way, Calvin, if you have any questions for Rico, feel free. Rico, you know, we posted a picture of you. You probably haven't seen it.
He wasn't born when I played.
Well, yeah, I do have a couple of questions. How's your golf?
trust me, I've seen him play. Rico, we posted a picture of you the day of the All-Star game on our Facebook page. You were standing in line, you know, along the baseline with Reggie Jackson. I think Bill Freehand was next to you.
Frank Howard.
My question to you is, when you guys played in the All-Star game, I mean, today, like I watched the game the other night, guys are hugging each other. They're joking around. Was it the same back then against the opposition, or did you guys play to win?
Well, we played to win, but you know, both teams. We got together for a dinner. They had a dinner or something the night before or whatever, and you know, we got to talk and to meet some of the other players from the other league, and you know, it was great. There was no doubt about it, but not like it is now. I mean, you know, in that way, the game has changed because, you know, with all the high fives, with all the coming out of the dugout, flipping the bats and all that. But as you said, Tom, it's entertainment. I think Major League Baseball doesn't mind that at all. And what they're trying to do, what this does is to, you know, they talk about the launch angle, home runs, the home run contest. This year was really good.
I thought so. It was entertaining.
Yeah, yeah.
It was very entertaining. Exactly. All right, listen, we're going to take a quick break. Calvin's in the house, Calvin Arnold from REA Auctions.
I got a question.
Yeah, we're going to come back. Yeah, we'll come back
With
Rico, on deck with Rico, and then we're going to chat with Calvin a little more. Stop it. Hang in there. We'll be right back.
Since 1996, Brian Drent and the staff at Denver's Mile High Card Company have led the charge in the collectibles hobby. Mile High is a full-service dealer specializing in buying and selling cards and offers a competitive consignment program for all collectors. Whether it be their computerized want list service, appraisals, or auction services, Mile High has it all. If you've been searching for a company with a selection of high-grade vintage 1888 to 1970 baseball cards and memorabilia that shares your passion, aim high. Mile High. Go to milehighcardco.com. or call 303-840-2784 for more information.
Hi, everyone. I'm Rico Petrocelli, and I'm very excited to talk to you about Panini America. Panini America is the world leader in licensed sports and entertainment collectibles, and we're proud to have them as the official trading card of the Great American Collectibles Show. When it comes to modern trading cards of your favorite players, Panini America leads the way in terms of innovation, design, creativity, value, and fun. From landmark brands such as Donruss, Prism, and Contenders, to high-end juggernauts like Flawless, National Treasures, and Immaculate, Panini America delivers the hottest trading cards of the biggest names in the NBA, NFL, MLB, PA, NASCAR, soccer, and college. When you want to collect the best, collect Panini America. Ask for it at your local hobby shop or at mass retailers like Target and Walmart. And you can always find Panini America online at iCollectPanini.com. Panini America, who do you collect?
Pristine Auction is a family-owned and operated online auction specializing in autographed memorabilia, sports cards, coins, art, and collectibles. Since their founding in 2010, they've grown to two facilities in Phoenix, Arizona, totaling over 60,000 square feet. Jared Cavalli and an incredible staff of over 150 team members serve a very large customer base and enjoy every minute of it. By working with leading authentication companies, Pristine ensures all items are 100% authentic. In addition, third-party authenticators regularly travel to Pristine Auction to provide authentication services on-site. Pristine Auction strives to operate its business in a way that's honoring to God, their families, and their customers. With a strong focus on speed, quality, and premier customer service, their mission is to be the leading online auction for every level of collector and fan. Pristine also works for Hope Sports and Identity Hoops International, traveling to Mexico to build houses for the less fortunate. Pristine Auction offers several online auction formats with thousands of auctions ending each day. For more information, go to pristineauction.com. That's Pristine Auction, the best in the business.
How would you like to own the bat that was used by your favorite player when he hit that towering home run or game-winning base hit? Now look no further than JT Sports, specializing in the sale and authentication of professional game-used bats. As the official authenticators of professional model game-used bats for PSA DNA, JT Sports will guarantee the authenticity of any bat purchased from them. JT Sports also buys and sells game-worn uniforms, gloves, and baseball equipment. The unique quality of the collectible is what JT Sports is all about. Give them a call at 609-487-8003 or check them out at GameUseBats.com.
Now on deck with Rico Pastorcelli.
Hi, my name is Chloe.
Hi, we're on deck with Rico Pastorcelli.
On deck with Rico Petrocelli. What we do every time Rico is on, we a viewer
we lose.
A viewer or a listener submits one question, and this week's giveaway is going to be this cool
Tony DeMarco
signed by former welterweight champ of the world, Tony DeMarco. Tony signed this a couple of weeks ago for us. And here is the question, Mr. Petrocelli. Are you ready?
Yes, I'm so excited.
This was submitted by Steve Friedman. And the question is, Rico, what is your all-time Red Sox outfield?
My all-time Red Sox outfield?
Yeah.
The three players that I, without any doubt in my mind, would be Jim Rice, Freddie Lynn, and Dwight Evans. It don't get any better.
No. Listen to me. The question is of all time. You're telling me that you would take one of those guys over Ted Williams?
It said the outfield, all three outfield. Who's the best outfield?
Of all time. No. My apologies. My apologies. I screwed up. All-time outfielders. Three outfielders from any generation. Who's your left fielder?
Ted Williams wasn't a good outfielder. We're not talking hitting, right? Are we? We're talking hitting?
No, we're talking the whole
all right,
player.
Ted, yeah, okay. Ted Williams.
Then who?
Then where? At center field?
Yeah.
Center field?
Ah, this is going to be tricky
this is
now.
A tough one. You got Dom DiMaggio. You got Clint Hurdle. No, he wasn't. You got Freddie Lynn. Oh, Jackie. Well, defensively, Jackie.
You would have Jackie Jensen. Well, what about offensively?
Well, it's a different story.
Fred Lynn. This isn't like science.
Yeah, you're confusing the whole thing.
I'm confusing you. The all-around player. Who's the all-around center fielder on your team? Freddie Lynn. Who's your left fielder?
Ted Williams.
He's going backwards,
right field. Dwight Evans, best.
That's interesting. That's really interesting.
Wait a second. I'll take a close second. Don't forget, I am because I played, on the same team.
Yeah, you can't. You're playing favorites with those guys.
Mookie Betts was a great player here while he was here in Boston. Yeah, he was. It's pretty close, but I go with Dwight Evans because Dwight was kind of a guy that didn't have, wasn't flashy and all that, and that just wasn't his style.
Fred Lynn and Dwight Evans.
For the Red Sox.
I would disagree with two of those three choices.
Yeah,
I would have. I don't care.
Harry Hooper.
If they're playing out of position, I would have Yaz, I would have Ted Williams, and I'd have Tris Speaker.
What are you talking about?
No, Mookie Betts.
Wait, who's in center field?
I would put Mookie Betts in center.
Who's in right?
I would move Ted to right.
Who's on first?
I would have Mookie.
That's a whole show. That's a whole show what you're talking about. So
Mookie
anyway,
Betts,
I got a question.
Go ahead.
Can I have a question?
You get one.
How can you say Jackie Jensen? Yeah. Jackie Jensen? How can you say Jackie
Who said
Jensen?
That?
You did.
Oh, he did.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I didn't say Jackie Jensen.
Yes, you did.
Calvin, tell us about what you're displaying at the National. Naturally, you guys are going to be at the National. What are you going to have out there?
Absolutely. I mean, we're going to have a lot of great stuff at the National. First of all, I'll let everybody know that we'll be at Boost 445, 544, and 546. Come on by and say hi. But we'll have a lot of great things. Anything from, 19th century to high-grade cards to vintage wax boxes to a very, very, very special item, which I will not reveal at this point, but you will want to come by the booth and take a look. It's going to be spectacular.
Excellent. What's hot and what's not right now, Calvin, in the card market? I mean, like, for instance, I know the Michael card has gone down in value a little bit. Is that card being replaced by something, or what's really hot right now?
Yeah, it's a great question. I don't know if it's being replaced. Jordan certainly can't be replaced. obviously we've seen the pullback in that. And I will go on record saying I think pullbacks in markets, any market, is a good, healthy thing for that market. Things cannot just simply go up forever. The Jordan card is I still think very, very collectible, very hot. If you think about pre-pandemic, that card was $25,000 and it's a quarter of a million. So we're still right. talking a very expensive card. But I think there's pockets of things that are hot, and I think some things are not. I think still, again, low pop, high grade, I'll keep saying this, rookie cards seem to be incredibly hot. I don't think they've slowed down in the least. I think some things that have slowed down is those things that are not in season, like especially modern. But again, once that season picks up, you're going to see that stuff pick up as well. Football season's almost upon us, and you're starting to hear buzz about some of these major football rookies and players, Burrow coming back, things like that. So I think it's hit or miss. I think you can there's always going to be things that are up and things that are down in any given market.
Rick?
Yeah. Yeah, I wanted to ask you about Mark. I'm a marketing guy, and I wanted to ask you about marketing. You know, you guys got catalogs, and could you tell us a little bit about your marketing for the company?
Yeah, so the marketing, I mean, most of that's done in-house. Obviously, I work remotely, but, you know, the catalog itself is a labor of love. I mean, 600 to 700 pages thick. I think it represents more of an extension of our commitment to the consignor. You know, with technology, a lot of people look things up online, but it's an incredible coffee table presentation, and it is really the centerpiece of our marketing. We do a lot of social media. We do first looks on Facebook. We do Instagram, so people get an idea of what things are coming up. So we do. We do a full-scale marketing through all channels, email blasts, like I said, print copy, social media. But the catalog itself is incredibly intensive, and I think it shows, you know, our commitment to our consigners.
You don't get – or do you get do you get a list of – maybe through the national, I don't know if they take names and addresses or emails and stuff like that for the kind of, the people that go there. I don't know if they do that, but is there any kind of lists that you guys go to that can that you can mail these catalogs out?
We have a pretty extensive list currently. I mean, domestically, internationally, that we already mail catalogs out. But yeah, if you come by the booth at the national, anybody that does not receive a catalog is free to sign up. We'll get you the catalog to the next auction, and that's how you get on the mailing list. But there's really no list generated. I think it's more outreach, Rico. Yeah. I think it's us doing our job. I think once the catalog's done, once the auction's live, you know, our job's not over. We continue to, you know, reach out to not only potential consigners, but also bidders when the auction's live. So we really do a full service job.
I still think the industry should have there should be an association for the industry so that they could do something like that and, you know, have it available to probably everybody. But that's just my opinion.
Speaking of marketing, Rico, maybe you can help me out because, you know, I don't know if you're aware of this, but the Great American Collectibles Show, we're going to be broadcasting from the National. We have some great giveaways. We're going to have some beautiful Great American Collectibles t-shirts, some hats that say the Great American Collectibles Show. And the marketing company hasn't returned my phone call. It says, hold on, let me look. Petrocelli Marketing. You think maybe that you could check on the status of our order so that we may be able to get them to Chicago by the time
I've had a bad back.
Freaking plane?
I have a bad back, Tom, and it's really tough. I hope you understand. We'll get it out before the National.
You can't interrupt his golf game like that, Tom.
You know, I mean, it's like trying to get stuff from him is like trying to get a root canal. It's like
thanks a lot. You know what you're doing now? All the customers that we have, they're all gone. They're all gone now. Thanks.
No, you guys actually put out some good products. Mike showed me a template. I'm really kind of pleased.
We'll get it to you.
I know. I'm sure you will. Calvin.
Yeah.
Calvin, how about tell us a little bit about your background.
Background's pretty straightforward. You know, obviously I collected cards as a kid, like most of us. And as I graduated high school, didn't really have a direction, you know, but happened to go by a local card shop that had Help Wanted sign in it, and I was able to turn my childhood passion into my career. So here I am, you know, many, many decades later, unfortunately.
Now you're in Vegas, right?
I am. I'm in Vegas.
And you live there year round?
I do live here year round. Yep.
So. People actually live in Vegas year round, Rico.
Well, that's a lot.
You know, I bounce around between the Bellagio and Aria and Venetian, and you know, so hotels have been really good to me. No, I'm kidding. There's a city outside of Vegas, so it's not just the strip.
Everybody thinks of the Strip, but there's a lot of people who moved out there.
No, I know it's actually there may be a football team.
They're already here. So the stadium is built, Allegiant Stadium. It's absolutely
beautiful,
and. You know,
they'll get a baseball team soon. Can I ask you guys a question and get your opinion?
Sure.
I have two baseballs here. They're signed. They're not signed by anyone except that they have on them. Can you see them? It's the president this way.
Yeah. What is
Lee McPhail? That's Lee McPhail, president, American League ball. Wait a second. Let me show you the other one. If I can, I got it upside down. Yeah, here we go. Let's see if you could see that this way.
Who signed
that
it?
That is
Joseph Cronin.
Cronin. Joe Cronin.
Yep.
Oh, so did Joe sign it?
No, it's not signed, but I was just wondering. That's all. You know,
I'll give you $8 for each of them.
I was trying to get 5,000 each. I mean, what?
What are you talking about? Tom overpays at $8.
REA, I'll tell you. I mean, REA, Calvin, I'll tell you. Rico has some memorabilia that he doesn't even know he has. And I've been on him for a year and a half now. He's got this basement that's filled with just some really cool stuff. But he refuses to take the time to catalog it. I told him I would help him. I mean, his 1967, we took out his 1967 uniform. It looked like a piece of Swiss cheese from all the moth holes.
Wow.
Look, no, I'm kidding. Hey, I'm only kidding.
Great preservation there.
I got four sons. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you gotta split it up with them if they want it. But
really?
Anyway, okay.
One gets
all right.
The right leg, the other gets the left leg.
Yeah,
exactly.
What's going on here?
Calvin, what's going on with speculation? I mean, is there too much speculation going on?
You know, sometimes, obviously, you know, you can have a lot of speculation, but I think sometimes, you know, speculation can be good. I mean, people are taking their shots. I mean, I live here in Vegas. I mean, people go to the window all the time and speculate on the team that's going to win, right? You know, they want the potential big payoff. You know, and so I think that drives a lot of the speculation. So I don't necessarily look at speculation in a negative light. I think it's healthy. I mean, if obviously within constraints, of course. But I think speculation today is vastly different than speculation 30 years ago. I mean, you could speculate on a card. I bought 887 Topps Oda B. McDowell's for 10 cents a piece. I mean, you know the big star he turned out to be. So, but nowadays, like. These guys that are not even big stars are, you know, starting at $100, $150, $200 a card. So, I mean, I just think it's a different level. It's a different game. And I think speculation plays into the modern card market. I think it plays into the younger collectors. I think it's exciting. You know, we talk about it being exciting and entertaining. I mean, I think that's just an exciting way for them to participate and potentially hit big.
Could you tell us a little bit about your auction schedule for the rest of the year?
Absolutely. So we have two more encores slated for this year, September. It'll open up mid-September, and the next one will open up mid-October. And then we have our third catalog auction, which will be our fall catalog auction, and that opens up mid-November, closes like the first week in December. So we got three more opportunities for getting your great pieces in REA's auctions.
Hey, Calvin. As far as consignments, do the different auction houses, yourselves, the Heritages, the Memory Lanes, I mean, I'm assuming that you guys, the bulk of your business comes from regular consigners that do business with you on a day in, day out basis. I mean, is that pretty much like you have your regular customers that both buy and sell? Is that how it works?
Yeah, we definitely have regular consigners that we call on, regular collectors, regular guys in the hobby. So we certainly use that to our advantage and to obviously their advantage. But we also have a lot of people that find us through our marketing efforts. You know, you have guys that, you know, either through, you know, what do they say? The three D's, right? Death, divorce, and whatever. But, you know, you have that. You have guys that find things through various means. They do Google searches and, you know, so they come to us. But we're able to obtain a lot of material through a lot of different avenues. But our regular consigners are very important to REA's business.
Are you a collector yourself?
Absolutely, 100%.
And what do you specialize in? What is your favorite?
The largest portion of my collection is unopened material.
Really?
Yep.
Yeah, that's a phenomena. I mean, that's just has really exploded over the last several years. Rico, think about some of the packs that went through your hands as a kid growing up in Brooklyn, and if you had them today and you had never opened them, how much would those bad boys be worth, right?
Please, yeah.
I mean, you were collecting. I mean, the 52 Tops set was before my time. I mean, I was a little kid. I was like a year or two old. But so I was collecting 56, 57, 58s. But 52. Sure. I mean, you collected a lot of 52s, right? 52s, 53s, Rico.
Oh, ton of them. I mean, all those years. Are you kidding me? With the gum, we wanted the gum, but you know, I was looking for Mantle. Finally got a 52 Mantle, which is, forget it. I don't want to even talk about it. Yeah, but all the kids, you know, they flipped them. We flipped them against the wall and all that kind of stuff. That's everyone has that story at that age. But it was exciting. It was exciting, and that's what's needed, that excitement. And Tom, to me, remember we did it at the show, and they picked the Mantle.
Oh, right. That was Leighton picked a 56 Bowman.
Leighton, yeah, 75 grand. Yeah. But we had a crowd there. It was exciting.
And the crowd went crazy.
Yeah, they were nuts. And people like that now, especially young guys, young people. They love that excitement. You know, they're watching all these movies with
and it's their idols. It's their idols too.
Yeah. You know what so I mean? Anyway.
I mean, Rico, we talked about this. You know, you were a Mickey fan as a kid growing up. You idolized Mickey Mantle, right?
Yeah.
Now you fast forward
I idolize you.
Thank you. You're a professional baseball player. What was the feeling like the first time you had interaction with Mickey Mantle? I don't know if he was playing first. I'm assuming, you know, you're on base at one time. He's the first baseman. What was the feeling like?
It was very exciting to be next to Mickey. You know, even like I said, in those days you couldn't fraternize with the other team, so I couldn't go up to the batting cage and even introduce myself to Mantle. Right. You know, that was the rules. And so I had to wait. And when he was playing first base, I probably walked, you know, and here it is. I'm right next to Mickey Mantle. It's a funny thing.
That must have been crazy.
You know, the first thing that came to mind that I thought, you know, on TV, like he was about 7.5 feet tall and about, you know, he was like my size as far as the height, my height. 5'11", but you know, close to 6 feet, maybe he was, and 180 pounds, 185 pounds. Wow. I mean, of course, he was ripped.
Did you say anything to him, or did he say anything to you?
Yeah. Well, I was hoping that you know, he would say something, but then I was afraid to say something. He might tell me, "Hey, kid, you know, take a hike here."
Right.
Or be crushed, you know. So finally, he took a lead. I came back. I was ready to say something. And he turns around and says, "Rick, how you doing?" Holy jeez. And I said, "Not bad, Mick. You know, I feel pretty good. Family's good.
That's classic.
What a thrill. It is. It's a thrill. It's a thrill to meet.
Calvin, can you imagine that? Right?
I can't even imagine. I mean, trying to rectify, like, somebody you watch on TV and then you're standing next to them. Like, I can only relate in the respect that when I was a kid collecting, I thought Babe Ruth was literally a mythical character, like not a real baseball player.
Yeah.
It was only until later that I realized, oh, this guy actually played baseball.
He's the real deal.
Yeah.
Hey, listen, we got about 30 seconds left. What is your website address?
Website is www.robertedwardauctions.com.
Fantastic. Look forward to seeing you at the National. Rico will not be there. Rico's going to be there. He's got his $50,000 pay weekend from the Red Sox.
He kills me every time.
50 Barry, grand you're paying him.
See what he
can
does?
Can you imagine he does? He gets $50,000.
Would I not be there if I could be there?
I don't know, Rico. You're on the fence to me. But
I'll tell you, Calvin, he's getting paid 50 grand to eat hot dogs.
That's a lie. You know that.
I know. I'm kidding.
You know that.
All right, Calvin. All right, listen, take care of yourself.
Yeah, great having you on, Calvin.
Hey, really, it was great to be on. Thanks a lot, guys. Have a great day.
All right, take care.
Take care.
All right, we're going to take a quick break. We come back. Big Al's joining us. Al Crisafulli from Love of the Game Auctions. Rico, you look good today. You look rested.
Yeah, right.
We'll be right back.
My name is Davis. Please consider making a donation to the Jimmy Fund and Dana-Farber Cancer Institute and help stamp out cancer in kids. We have all been touched by cancer, but we can win the battle. Please make your donation, and remember, no amount is too small. The Jimmy Fund is the official charity of the Boston Red Sox. Thanks very much.
Hi, I'm Rico Petrocelli. I hope you listen to my pal Davis and make a contribution. We want to make children's cancer a thing of the past, and with your help, we can do it. Just go to TomZappalaMedia.com to make your charitable donation.
Panini America is the world leader in licensed sports and entertainment collectibles, and we are proud to have them as the official trading card company of the Great American Collectibles Show. Panini leads the way in innovation and design with great brands like Donruss, Prism, Contenders, Flawless, National Treasures, and Immaculate. Partnering with the NBA, NFL, Major League Baseball Players Association, NASCAR, FIFA, and college, Panini is certainly at the head of the hobby. You can find Panini products in major retailers like Walmart and Target, or online at iCollectPaniniAmerica.com. That's Panini America. Who do you collect?
This is Brian Drent, president of Mile High Card Company. Is your sports card and memorabilia collection properly insured? For easily replaced personal property, homeowners insurance is all most people need. But for prized possessions that you may have spent a lifetime collecting, it doesn't go nearly far enough. Collectibles Insurance Services has been insuring for over 50 years. They offer a full range of protection and a $0 deductible at an affordable rate with no appraisals required. I know because they insure my collection. If you have a minute, go to collectinsure.com and learn more about insuring your personal card or memorabilia collection.
Hi, this is Dan from Memory Lane Auction and Collectibles Company. If you're looking to maximize your return on your sports cards and collectibles, look no further. We at Memory Lane Auction House offer you several options to achieve top dollar for your collectibles. Whether you're looking to auction or sell privately, we're the number one choice with over 17 years in the hobby. Nobody will work harder to achieve your goals. Just call us today at 877-606-5263. That's 877-606-LANE. Or visit us on the web at www.memorylaneinc.com. Go with the best. Go with Memory Lane.
Okay, we are back, and this segment of the Great American Collectibles Show is brought to you by eBay, your number one sport spot for cards and collectibles. List your inventory with confidence on eBay. Did you know, Rico, that eBay trading cards' top-rated sellers are no longer required to offer remorse returns in order for their listings to qualify for the top-rated plus 10% final value fee discount?
Yes.
Did you know that?
Yeah,
you
did? I did.
Oh. Yep. That means no more stressing about bad buyer behavior because eBay has your back. For more information, go to ebay.com/returns to learn more. How's that?
Yeah, good.
David, nice job. Do we have Big Al on with us? Big Al.
There he is. There, you know, guys.
Yeah.
You know, you kind of look like, you know, I was trying to, you kind of look like the, what's his name? The guy that used to sing for Journey.
Yeah.
Right? Steve Perry.
Great. Steve Perry. Just the three of us on the screen. I've never seen so much ugly on my computer all
this time. How you doing? All right.
Doing all right. How are you guys?
Good. I don't know. Right. I know. Listen, again, it's Friday and they're watching on Wednesday. But I don't know if you heard the beginning of the show. Did you get the notice on?
I did.
Tough one. Good friend. Very, very dear friend. You know what he means to us, Ellen and I. We have a lot of history together, and he's going to be missed. But he's really brought this industry to a different level.
Sure, he's a pro, but he's going to land on his feet, you know. And so, you know, we hope or I hope to see him back in the industry quick.
Yeah, Rico and I are thinking about
not with any competitors of mine.
Well, Rico and I were thinking about buying out Heritage Auctions as well as Memory Lane, Sotheby's, and Christie's together. We're gonna like pitch our money together and then hire Joe to run it for us. So, Rico, it was a simple question. I said, Rico, can you come up with $500 or $600 million? And he won't do it. I just don't understand that.
I only have $400 million on me. How can I do it? Jeez.
All right, now let's talk about the National. Big doings on the National. What do you got going on? Anything special?
Yeah. Well, we'll be just about ready to kick off our summer auction. That'll launch right after the National when we get back, maybe like the following week. So we'll be there to accept consignments for our fall auction, which we always do with the National, and then also to display items that that are going to be in that next summer auction. So it's always fun. It's always fun to see everybody and shake everybody's hand and all that.
Do you know what booth you're at?
1021.
1021, because we'll be coming by with the old camera crew.
Nice.
We're gonna be doing about 12 or 13 little 2-minute vignettes with some of our sponsors. It's just some, you know, walking the floor, and then we'll be posting it on the Facebook page over the next several months. So,
but no Rico, I heard you're not gonna be there.
Nah, you know something. You know this guy. I give up. I give up. You know, it's all with him. It's all about. He goes like this. I said, Rico, you coming? That's not true. This is what he does.
No. Al, that's not true. You know.
No, I'm kidding. He's got a Red Sox gig, and he's got bigger fish to fry and more responsibilities with the Red Sox. Because frankly,
are they gonna play tonight? I heard they're going to play.
Are they?
That's what I heard. Yeah, I heard that the Yankees haven't had any more positive tests, and so they're gonna get the game in.
Well, I was worried about actually some of the Red Sox players, you know, what's his name? Devers, like he spent a lot of time with Judge at the at the All-Star game.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah, but you know something, I mean, quite frankly, Al, I know you're a Yankee guy, but that team, man, there's not much there.
This is the same team that was supposed to go all the way to the World Series this year.
I don't know what's going on. So Rick,
it's on paper, of course, you know, spring training, although they have a lot of excellent players. I mean, come on.
Yeah. But nobody's hitting the ball.
Yeah.
They're
a home run hitting team. They have to hit home runs to win. And, you know, if you get the, plus they have injuries, they got a lot of injuries in the club. And, it's tough. It's tough to, you know, always wait for the home run to win ball games.
Yeah, I think that's a big problem with how they're built.
Yeah.
The saying is good pitching always beats good hitting, right? So and here we are.
Yeah. So, Al, you've had a great run over the last year and a half, 2 years. You really have. After the National. What's down the line for love of the game?
I'm going to retire.
Yeah, with the money you've made, you should retire.
You know, I think one of the things that has always, you know, we're a vintage sports auction company, and there has been a huge trend towards modern stuff and the hobby is embracing that, and that's great, but our specialty is you know, vintage sports cards and memorabilia, and that's what it's always going to be. And so, you know, we'll just keep going along the route that we're going. And yeah, when some of the blue chip stuff comes along, we'll pick that up and we'll feature that in the auction. But, you know, for the most part, I, you know, we sell the kind of stuff that I'm sort of into.
Well, you know something, but you're making a very good point. And Calvin Arnold from REA was on prior to you, and he basically is saying the same thing, that he's a vintage guy, I'm a vintage guy, and
yeah,
this new, he feels that this new group of investors, this young, these young modern hobbyists, he thinks that they're going to help the vintage market eventually. And I kind of agree with that.
I, you know, it's funny because vintage collectors and all of us in the vintage side of the hobby, we live in this sort of vacuum where we talk about how the, you know, the modern collectors are going to come in and, you know, help. And it's true. There's always going to be a certain amount of the hobby of collectors who come in and start with modern material and then, you know, sort of go backwards because they want material from you. But the reality is that the modern hobby dwarfs the vintage hobby. The modern hobby is enormous. And
I
always love listening to the vintage people saying things like, oh, modern's starting to catch up to modern
has surpassed
vintage, you know. And absolutely. And so, you know, but it's that's a place where that's our comfort zone. And it's, you know, I much prefer to have a smaller auction full of stuff you don't see all the time.
Listen, I've never gone wrong. I said this at the beginning of the show. I have never gone wrong. I can look at my entire vintage collection, and if I can find two cards that have lost value over the last 35 years, that's a lot. You know, that's just the way it is.
You both better be watching out for the culture as it grows.
Absolutely.
What is happening? I'm just saying, down the road, you know.
But you're right. We see all of these, you know, these modern, you know, one of one, and they're great. Don't get me wrong, they're great. But then I have this, you know, PSA graded pack, right? And it's a cello pack with the Nolan Ryan rookie card on top. How many of these are you going to see?
Exactly. Like,
this kind of stuff, you know, it's sort of, you know, special.
Exactly.
You know, so it's really hard for me to, and that's just the cards. It's not the memorabilia.
Listen, you're preaching. I feel the same way. You're preaching to the choir. Yeah.
It's you know, this is not to denigrate the modern hobby. It's just, this is what we do. And,
I agree.
You know,
so I couldn't agree with you more. All right, listen, our giveaway, before we let Al go, these are 20 very, very, very extremely mediocre cards. led by the immortal Greg Ellis, Dallas Cowboys defensive end. These are all from like 1989, 87, 91, baseball, football. Jeff George. Now, this guy is probably the biggest bust in the history of quarterbacks in the NFL, and you can own Jeff George. So that's fantastic, right?
Uh-huh.
This week's winner out of the Staten Island Joe bag of tricks that I guarantee you Staten Island Joe knuckled this bag from the Hall of Fame. This week's winner is Brian Maurer. Brian Maurer. Brian, you know the rules.
Congratulations, Brian.
Brian Maurer. Mm-hmm. He's got 1 week to get in touch with us via text, PM, email. If I don't hear from you in a week, you're out. Fair enough. Right?
Right.
You okay with that, Rico?
That's it. Yeah. Hey, listen. That's
all right, Al. Your website address.
Loveofthegameauctions.com, and at the National, we're at booth 1021.
1021.
Come by and get a bottle of hand sanitizer.
Hey, all right.
That's what we're doing.
That's pretty cool.
Little Love of the Game hand sanitizer.
That is pretty cool. Very cool.
I'm going to be squirting it all over.
All right, Al. Listen, have a great week. We'll see you in a couple of weeks. Looking forward to seeing you. Take care. Al Crisafulli from Love of the Game. Good guy, man. Rico, I'm going to miss you. I'm really going to miss you at the National.
I wish I could do it, but I just can't do it this year. And, you know, you got to do what you got to do, Tom.
I know that, and I know I've been teasing you, but
I'll miss everybody.
We're gonna miss you, and I'm gonna miss JM too. Ellen and I. Ellen's gonna do it with me. Ellen
is great.
She's a behind the scenes person, so she doesn't want to be in front of the camera.
Why don't you have her on camera once in a while?
She refuses. I've asked her a thousand times. Right, but anyway, listen. Have a great week.
Yes, you too.
By the way, I'll see you sometime this week for lunch because I have to pick up that. That material from Petrocelli Marketing.
Yeah.
Let me know what your schedule is, and I'll revolve my schedule around you so we can grab. I'll pick up the shirts and hats, and we'll grab a bite.
Okay, you're paying, right? Time.
Oh God, no.
Okay, I'll pay. You know, I don't mind.
Gave you $1.5 million worth of business on my t-shirts and hats.
Just charge it to
not me. It's my son's company. I don't.
The figurehead.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Have a great week, everyone.
Yeah, you too.
We will be back next week, and then the week after, we're going to be doing a 2-hour special show from the National. With that being said, happy collecting. Yeah.